Hello everyone, welcome to Math Advice. In this video, I am going to explain one of the most widely used coefficient of correlation, that is Corpuscle coefficient of correlation, or otherwise it is also known as product moment correlation coefficient. You know already, correlation is the degree of relationship between the two variables. Based on correlation, we have to measure both the direction and the strength of the relationship between the two variables. That is, the extent to which the two variables are related to each other, which has to be measured using the concept of correlation. Also, it is one of the mathematical methods for measuring the linear relationship between the variables. So, here we have to discuss about the linear case, not about non-linear case. Pearson's correlation coefficient is a widely used linear correlation measure and was developed by Carl Pearson. The Corpuscle coefficient of correlation is represented by a symbol R. We use the symbol R to represent correlation coefficient. It is used to measure both the direction and strength of the relationship between the two variables. I'll just give you the interpretation of correlation coefficient, that is nothing but R. The value of R lies between minus 1 to plus 1. That is, it has to take all the values in between minus 1 to plus 1. Here, the sign of R, that is, we have two signs. Either it may be positive or negative, that is plus or minus. Here, the sign of R, that is plus or minus, denotes the direction of relationship between the two variables. If it is positive, there exists a positive correlation between the two variables. If it is negative, there exists a negative relationship between the two variables. That is negative correlation between the two variables. And the value of R denotes the strength of relationship between the two variables. So, correlation coefficient gives the magnitude and direction of relationship between the two variables. For example, let me take two values. The first value of R is plus 0.915 and the second value of R is minus 0.237. So, based on this value, we have to interpret the correlation between the two variables. Before that, let me give you a short intro about the strength of the relationship, whether it may be stronger or weaker. If the value of R is equal to plus 1, then we call such type of correlation as a perfect positive correlation. If the value of R, which is equal to minus 1, then there exists a perfect negative correlation between the two variables. If R is exactly equal to 0, then there exists no correlation between the two variables. If R lies between 0, that is except 0 to except 0.5, in this range, if R takes the value in this range, then there exists a low positive correlation between the two variables. If R takes the value from 0.5, that is including 0.5 to 1, that is except 1. If R takes a value in this range, then there exists a high positive correlation between the two variables. So, similar is the case for negative side 2. If R takes a value from 0, that is except 0 to except 0.5, that is minus 0.5, there exists low negative correlation. If R takes a value from minus 0.5, that is including minus 0.5 to minus 1, except minus 1, if R takes a value in this range, there exists a high negative correlation between the two variables. So, based on the range, the value of R falls, and based on the sign of R, we have to interpret what type of relationship exists between the two variables. Now let me give the interpretation about the R here. Here R takes a value plus 0.915. If it is plus, so there exists a positive correlation. 0.915. If it is 0.915, that is approximately 0.9. It is approximately here, isn't it? So if it falls in this range, so there exists high negative correlation between the two variables. So the direction is positive, and based on the magnitude, that is, we have to say there exists high positive correlation between the two variables. So if R value is equal to plus 0.915, then there exists a high positive correlation between the two variables. This is what our conclusion based on the value of R. So there exists a strong relationship, which means there exists a strong relationship between the two variables X and Y. Let's move on to another one. If R takes a value minus 0.237, here look at the sign, that is negative. So there exists a negative correlation. And the value of that is magnitude is 0.237. If it is minus 0.237, minus 0.2, you have to take approximately here. So if this value falls in this range, then there exists a low negative correlation. So based on this value of R, our conclusion is there exists low negative correlation between the two variables. So if there exists low negative correlation, means this relationship between the two variables is weaker. Coefficient of correlation between the two variables X and Y is defined as R is equal to covariance between X and Y over product of standard deviations of X and Y. That is, here R is a numerical measure which is used to measure the linear relationship between the two variables X and Y, and is defined as the covariance between X and Y to the product of the standard deviations of X and Y. By just substituting the formula for covariance and standard deviations, we may get the formula in this form. That is 1 over 1 n sigma x minus x bar y minus y bar over under root 1 over n sigma x minus x bar the whole square and under root 1 over n sigma y minus y bar the whole square. This is the formula for calculating standard deviation of x, and this is the formula for calculating standard deviation of y, and this is the formula for calculating the covariance between x and y. Now, we are having so many methods available for calculation of Cartesian coefficient of correlation. These are all some of the methods which we have used to calculate the Cartesian coefficient of correlation. The first one is actual mean method, second one is direct method, and third one is shortcut method or assumed mean method, and the last one is step deviation method. So based on the given data, we have to prefer either the first, second, third or fourth. So I will explain how to prefer the methods to calculate the Cartesian coefficient of correlation. Now, you know already this is the formula, general formula which we are used to calculate Cartesian coefficient of correlation. Here, we just cancel the value of n. Just simplify this. You just simplify this, we get the formula, this formula, isn't it? R is equal to sigma x minus x bar y minus y bar whole divided by under root sigma x minus x bar the whole square sigma y minus y bar the whole square, isn't it? So after simplification, we get this formula. So this method is nothing but actual mean method. So the formula used to calculate the value of R is using this formula is known as actual mean method. Here the deviations, that is x minus x bar and y minus y bar. Here we have to take the deviation, that is difference of values from x bar and y bar. That is x bar and y bar are the arithmetic means of x and y. So when we use this formula, as if the given values of x and y are very small in numbers and also x bar and y bar values are whole numbers. In such cases, we make use of this method to calculate the correlation coefficient. So, the if values of x and y, that is values of the variables given in the problem is very small and also x bar and y bar value is a whole number, in such cases we make use of actual mean method to calculate the Karp-Pearson's coefficient of correlation. Suppose if the given values of x and y, variables x and y values are small in numbers but x bar or y bar or x bar and y bar, both of them take the value of fractions like this. For example, if x bar takes the value 0.95 or y bar takes the value 5.75, something like this. So instead of integers as a whole number, if you take the values like x bar in terms of fraction like this, 0.95, 5.75, in such cases, if you prefer the actual mean method, definitely it will be difficult to calculate the value of x minus x bar. Suppose if you choose this x minus x bar, what happens? So definitely the calculation part becomes very tedious one. So very complicated one to calculate the value of r. In such cases, we go for the direct method. So we use the direct method when the values of x and y are small in numbers and also x bar and y bar values are in any one of the values or both of the values are in terms of fractions. So in such cases we make use of this direct method. For that we make use of this formula. When we go for shortcut method or assumed mean method, is suppose if the given values of x and y are not small in numbers, if it is in terms of large numbers, definitely if we choose the direct method, the product of xy and the product of x square, these are the very lengthy calculations. If we are doing the calculations for xy and sigma x square, so the calculation part becomes very tedious one. So in order to simplify the calculation, we go for the shortcut method. So if the given values of x and y are large in numbers, then we go for the shortcut method or assumed mean method. In this method, the deviations are taken from the assumed mean. Then the last one. Here in the shortcut method, we have to take the deviations from the assumed mean. So after calculating the deviations, if all the deviations of x or y are both of the series, that is both the deviations of x and y are either of the deviations of x or y is divided by some constant value, then we move to step deviation method. So in step deviation method, so the calculation part has to be simplified to get the value of r. This is the only difference. So we use the actual mean method. I just repeat all this once again. We use actual mean method whenever the values of x and y are very small in numbers. Also the arithmetic mean, x bar and y bar are whole numbers like 20, 30, 40, something like that, 12. So if it is whole numbers like that, we have to choose the actual mean method. Even though the value of x and y are small in numbers, if x bar or y bar values or x bar or y bar, any one of the values or both the values takes the fractions like 17.9 or 22.5, something like that, in such cases we have to go for direct method. Suppose if the given values of x and y are large in numbers, we may choose a shortcut method or assumed mean method. In this method, we have to take the deviations of the values from the assumed mean. So when we go for the step deviation method, after calculating the deviations of the values from the assumed mean, if all the values of x, that is deviations of x or deviations of y or both deviations of x and y, is divided by some constant values, then we move for step deviation method. So these are the four methods which we have used to calculate Karpiussian's coefficient of correlation. And we have to decide which method we have to use, that is based on the given data. Hope you got a clear idea about Karpiussian's coefficient of correlation. And let me discuss all this method one by one in the next video. Thanks for watching. See you again in my next video.